Now on RT1, Bryan Dobson meets Dr. Louise Richardson, Principal and Vice Chancellor of the University of St Andrews in Scotland and expert in international security.
Louise, thank you very much indeed for talking to us on One to One. You made history this year when you became the first woman principal and vice chancellor of St Andrews University in Scotland, one of the most famous universities in the UK, one of the oldest, one of the most prestigious, I think frequently rated as one of the top universities in the top 10 in Britain. Now, how did that come about? Were you headhunted? How did it all happen?
Well, thanks very much for having me, Brian. Delighted to be here. It was a fairly circuitous route from Waterford to St Andrews. Via Trinity College in Dublin, many years in the States at Harvard, and ultimately at St Andrews. I think increasingly the higher echelons of academia is becoming a global market, so universities tend to headhunt overseas. So it was a combination of being headhunted and applying and conversations with people. My youngest son was about to enter high school, so I had itchy feet from having spent many years at Harvard, and decided it was probably time to make a move, and if I was going to make a move, I either had to move last year or wait 4 years until he was finished high school. So when headhunters started to call, unlike in previous years where I'd said the timing isn't right, this time I said, well, let's talk. So I was very lucky to end up with a number of different options, but the position at St Andrews was the most appealing, the most challenging, and the most exciting one. So,
And is it the case that you would receive regular approaches? Or did you let it be known that you were interested in making a move?
Every year on this cycle for the last several years, I've been approached by various headhunters about various positions. I think that's quite common. I'm sure it's common in business, and I think increasingly it's common in academia. Having gone from being a straightforward academic, if you will, to having moved for the past 7.5 years into a combination of academia and administrative jobs. So very often it's hard to find academics with good administrative or managerial skills. Sometimes the skills that are required to become a good academic often are not those that lend themselves to managerial competence.
Well, now you've explained the timing for various family reasons, but why St Andrews?
Oh, it's an extraordinary place. It has this really unique combination of the local and the global. It's in a very small community, so a very powerful sense of community, and yet has students from over 100 countries. So it's really quite cosmopolitan as well as being quite local. It also has a world-renowned reputation in the areas I know best, international relations, study of terrorism. I had actually been on the International Advisory Board for the Centre for the Study of Terrorism at St Andrews. St Andrews established the centre in the early 90s, long before anybody else had, so I knew the university. I also think it's actually the ideal size for a university. There's about 7,000 students. So we're big enough to compete with the bigger, the older universities for the top students, the top professors, the biggest research grants, but we're also small enough really to have an impact on the life of every student who comes in there. And I felt the size of St Andrews lent itself to that.
I suppose maybe most people in this country, if they've heard of St Andrews, it would be because Prince William, the heir to the British throne, was an undergraduate there. So that underlines, I suppose, that it is very much an establishment institution, is it, with traditions that have been handed down through the centuries.
That's right. It's almost 600 years old. It'll be 600 years old in a couple of years. So it's a very old, very traditional university. That's true. Deeply rooted in Scottish and indeed British society. But it's also very forward-looking. And I would have thought that the decision to appoint somebody like me is fairly forward-thinking, I would have thought. We have about a third of our students are Scottish, a third are EU, and that's primarily English. And then a third are international. So it really is quite a good mix.
So when you take on this job, did you take it on with a particular agenda for change? Did you submit a plan for how you see the university developing, how it would develop under your leadership?
I think it's a fabulous institution, but I think it can be better. So yes, I did present not so much a blueprint for change, but areas that I think need development. We were ranked third behind Oxford and Cambridge 2 weeks ago in the Times league table. So we're still very good, but I think we can, as I say, be better. One of the areas that the new areas that I plan to bring is an effort to diversify sources of revenue for universities. We're publicly funded, which is quite different from my experience in the States, and that means we're very constrained. And so I plan to raise, I hope to change the culture around fundraising for education by raising money privately amongst graduates of the university, both in the UK and overseas. Mm. I think increasingly universities are going to have to be just a little more entrepreneurial and ambitious about raising revenue so that we're not entirely dependent on the government.
Yeah, well, we were having a debate here, as you probably know, about the reintroduction of third-level fees. The situation in Scotland is as here, that Scottish-British students don't pay fees.
There are no fees in Scotland. English students do pay fees, or there's a cap of £3,000 in fees. Scottish students pay none. International students do pay fees. Yeah.
Is that a sustainable model, free third-level education, do you think?
I think one can have good free third-level education. I don't think you can have excellent third-level education if we're dependent on fees and we're going to be constrained by or competing with other parts of the public sector for money. To have the kind of university that I think St Andrews has been historically and is now, but to sustain that into the future, I think we need more than public funding. So the money has to come from somewhere. It could be fees, and or it could be one could imagine a variety of mechanisms. But the area that I want to push on is raising money privately, while also lobbying for increased government funding.
Yeah, because another concern of yours is broadening access to the university, isn't it, and ensuring that more people from disadvantaged backgrounds who mightn't traditionally have thought of St Andrews as a place where they would study, that the opportunity would be there for them.
Absolutely. And again, I think we can learn a lot from American universities, where really the most elite and expensive universities are the most socially diverse. And my eldest daughter started at Harvard last year. We pay nearly $50,000 for her to attend Harvard. But the day she moved in, she called that evening and she said, she had five roommates, and she said, "Mom, I feel so inadequate. I'm the only girl who speaks English to my parents." So the Harvard Endowment is wealthy enough that other kids, children of immigrants whose families don't have the money to pay the fees, if they're smart enough to get in, they can afford to go, and that's terrific.
How do you preserve the independence and the integrity of the university and at the same time be funded by whether it's private individuals or maybe more significantly business interests, you know, the chemical industry, the pharmaceutical industry, the IT industry? And the fear, I think, of many people in the third level sector is that that would then put pressure on them to be researching particular areas. It would compromise their work.
Oh, I think the secret to raising money, whether it's government or from private sources, is to raise money to do what we want to do. We're not think tanks. Universities are not think tanks. We're not there to do businesses research. They have their own R&D departments for that. If their interests are aligned with ours, then it makes sense for us to do that. But universities have to do what we're designed to do. And then that will have a payoff on the economy and broader society, I'm sure. But if I could just go back to the widening access, I mean, I think you're right. Traditionally, St Andrews has been seen as, frankly, an elitist institution. I think the appointment of somebody like me challenges that. And by my speaking quite publicly in favour of widening access might encourage students to apply. Part of the problem is students from deprived backgrounds don't think of applying to a place with a reputation like St Andrews. I want them to think about applying, and if they're good enough to get in, I then want to be able to have the resources raised privately or publicly to make it affordable for them to come.
But you'd be then trying to reverse a trend, won't you? Because I read somewhere, in fact, that the number of students from the state sector entering St Andrews has actually gone down in recent years.
That's right, and that's something I have to change.
And you change that by telling them that St Andrews is available to them, and by looking maybe at the way the university goes about doing its business?
Yes, that's right. When you talk to people at St Andrews, they're utterly committed to widening access, and we've just launched a whole series of initiatives. We have students going out to schools, students from deprived backgrounds, from schools that rarely send children to St Andrews. We have students going back to those schools and talking about their experiences. I can go, or somebody of my generation, and we will have no credibility talking to 16 and 17-year-olds. But if students just a couple of years older than them go, they're much more likely to be credible.
Before taking up this appointment in St Andrews, you had been working and living in the United States in Harvard, and had been at Harvard for many, many years. And you went, in fact, to America in the late 1970s. You'd been a student at Trinity at that stage. You got a scholarship. Did you feel drawn to America? Was it somewhere you particularly wanted to live and work? How did that happen?
It was more by accident than design. I was in Trinity very conscious of being a fairly rough girl from the country compared to some of my smoother contemporaries. So I saw this ad in the Irish Times for a Rotary Fellowship, and I applied purely for the experience of that kind of competition. Nobody was more surprised than I was when I won it, and I was it enabled me to study any subject in the world I liked, any place in the world I liked. So I gave a list of five places, and Rotary opted for which one I should go to, and it was California. I had the most absolutely extraordinary year. I got no academic credit for it, but it was well worth it. In any event, having had that really mind-broadening experience, I came back to Trinity, finished my degree, but I was bound and determined to go back to the States, not because I was unhappy in Ireland, but just because there seemed so many opportunities there. I first went, got a scholarship for a master's degree, then got another scholarship for a PhD at Harvard. So it was a gradual process. But not driven by any particular desire to leave Ireland, but rather to gain experience. And
I mean, the contrast between the Ireland of the late 1970s and California or Harvard at that time mm-hmm. must have been just enormous.
Well, yes, I was studying medieval history in Trinity. You know, many of the students wore their gowns to lectures, or certainly had to wear gowns to attend commons in the evening. My first class at the University of California, I remember walking into the classroom and this guy in denim cutoffs with long hair and a beard sat in yoga pose on the table and said, "Hi, I'm Jeremy." And I remember thinking, I don't care who you are, but there's going to be a professor in here in a moment. And you've guessed it, Jeremy was the professor. But they were very rigorous about academics in a completely informal environment, and I found it absolutely exhilarating.
So when you graduated, there was no question but that if the opportunity arose, you were heading back to the States.
Absolutely. I came back determined to figure out a way of getting a scholarship to go back to America.
Yes. Yeah, so it was the opportunities that it presented, that was an important part of all this, the fact that they weren't hidebound by tradition. What were the factors that were drawing you back?
I think it was the fact that it's such an open society, such a meritocratic society. A society in which somebody who doesn't come from a privileged background but who makes their own way is respected for that, where class doesn't matter, where you're really judged by your individual merit and achievements. And I found that really exhilarating.
What about your background, family background? How important has that been for you? How much has it shaped the adult you became?
I'm very close to my family, several of whom still live in Tramore. I'm second of seven children. I think having a very strong family background in some sense rooted me, gave me a sense of permanence that I had the freedom then to experiment, because there always was the sense of a tight family at home in Tramore to whom I remain very close. But growing up in rural Ireland, being educated as I was educated in the local convent, that profoundly influenced my view on the world, the sense of history. I still remember, although I was very, very young at the time, the 50th anniversary of 1916, and just the sense of nationalism that permeated life, that permeated the way we were taught history in school. I think that has changed a great deal now. And it's not as though my family were a nationalist family who were had a strong political views, not at all. But you certainly imbibe that from the ether. And for somebody who is politically aware and politically interested as I was, we were getting very powerful nationalist messages. And at some level, my desire to study international relations was an effort to repudiate that nationalism into a broader
But world. When violence exploded in the north, and you've written and spoken about this, you became enormously engaged with what was happening there and developed very strong political views.
Yes, I did. I was a teenager growing up and in Ireland, as Northern Ireland was exploding, and I bought entirely into the Republican narrative, if you like. This seemed to me at the time, I no longer believe this, that this was just another case of British exploitation of Ireland. It seemed to fit in, it was just another part of the saga that we'd been taught at school, that this was British oppression, all of Ireland's ills, Ireland's poverty were all Britain's fault. So I bought that line, hook, line and sinker, until I was educated enough to question it.
And is it true your mother had to lock you in your bedroom at one stage? You wanted to head off and join a demonstration in Uri?
Well, this was right the week after the Bloody Sunday killings. I was I was consumed with rage at the injustice of that. And I, yes, I wanted to go up and march in Newry.
And were you typical, do you think, of your classmates and your friends, or was this an unusually strong reaction on your part?
Well, to be honest, I was more politically interested and politically aware, I expect, than most of my classmates and friends, who weren't terribly interested in politics at the age of 13 or 14. But I always was, because I found Irish history so fascinating. But my views, I think, were fairly typical of views of perhaps of people older than me, and certainly people who were politically interested, as indeed I was.
And then, is it true that at a later stage in Trinity, you were approached about joining the IRA, about becoming active?
That's right. When I went to Trinity, the Republican clubs were active and tried to recruit us, yes, or tried to recruit me, yes.
And how did that happen?
Well, I was just approached and asked to join, and went along to several meetings, and I got engaged in discussions in which, at that point, I was 17 or 18 then, and I said, look, I entirely share your aspirations and your views, but I don't think violence is the way to achieve them. So we had many debates. I went along to meetings, but decided I wasn't going to join. It was all entirely amicable. We debated, we argued, but I absented myself, but I saw others join. So moving away from republicanism was a process. But even at that point, I had decided that no, killing was not the way to do it.
Well, I suppose that takes us on to the area of study, mm-hmm. and research, which you're best known for in recent years, which is the study of international terrorism. And you started, I think, teaching a course at Harvard in the 1990s, and mm-hmm. it was seen as something of a marginal interest. Is that right at that time?
Oh, absolutely. In fact, the chairman of my department at the time said, this is academic suicide to work on terrorism. And it was really my students who drew me into it. I always read about terrorism, had a vast collection of books on my walls, with students in my room, in my office, seeing all the books on terrorism on my walls, saying, why don't you teach terrorism? Why? At the time, I taught American foreign policy, international security, areas like that. And I said, oh, terrorism is my hobby, it's not what I teach. So they lobbied me and said, all right, I'll teach a junior honor seminar next year. So these courses usually have about 5 or 6 students. They have a maximum cap of 12. Well, I had 133 show up the first day. So I said, okay, to prevent a riot, I said I'd teach a lecture course. And there's nothing like having to produce 30 lectures to focus your thinking on a subject. So that's what drew me in. And you know, I've always been completely fascinated by the question of terrorism. How do people who in other aspects of their lives are good parents, good teachers, upstanding citizens, and yet in the interest of a cause will commit atrocities? So I've always been fascinated by that, by how organizations can recruit people to sacrifice everything in a furtherance of a cause that the odds of their committing or achieving are almost nil.
How do you research, though, terrorism? Where are the primary sources, if mm-hmm. you like, for the sort of work you're doing?
Well, there's been a real change since September 11th, I would say. Prior to September 11th, I used to make contact with members of terrorist organizations. They were perfectly willing to talk to me. As I've said, I've never met a member of a terrorist group who didn't believe passionately in the legitimacy of his cause and the illegitimacy of his adversary. So they're perfectly willing to talk and make their case to you. Aside from that, terrorists, even in the late 90s, were using websites. I mean, there were only about a dozen terrorist websites in the late 1990s. There's hundreds now. But one could follow their websites, see their read their papers, their newspapers that they were producing for their local constituency, reading their propaganda and talking to them. So much as one would research any other organization.
And on one occasion, at least, I think you organized a seminar where you brought academics and terrorists together, is that right?
That's right. I mean, we politely call them activists rather than terrorists, but yeah, they were all members of different terrorist groups. Yes, in this particular instance, these were representatives of different nationalist terrorist groups, and we conducted ourselves much like an academic conference. We were in a remote location, so there was nobody else around. And I gave, for example, a paper on factors driving terrorist decisions to escalate to a new level of violence. And the number two man in a major terrorist group was the respondent, just like in an academic conference. He thought I was right in some areas, wrong in some areas, and we argued that. Another part of the conference, for a couple of days, we divided ourselves into groups of, as I say, activists and academics. And we had written scenarios. And so the idea was trying to establish what, again, what drives terrorist decisions to escalate. So we had imagined, written a scenario in which we were a Chechen cell in Moscow, and increasingly we were under more and more pressure. So what, when would we let out? When would we use a higher level of violence? And it was completely fascinating. I would say the activists were amazed at just how belligerent the academics were. And so the people who were more inclined to use violence were the hawks, whether they were academics or activists. And, you know, once a liberal, always a liberal. So I was always arguing for rational calculation of our resources. And but there was no difference.
The conclusion I think you draw from that and your other work is that really any of us could end up involved in terrorist activity.
I think that's right. I think that's absolutely right. I mean, psychologists who are absolutely unanimous on this point. People who've interviewed terrorists and former terrorists, terrorists of every ideological persuasion in every part of the world, are unanimous on this. Insofar as we understand normalcy, terrorists are as normal as the rest of us.
And yet only a tiny number of people get involved in this kind of activity. I mean, even if you take the Irish situation, only a few hundred people, maybe at most, were active in the IRA. So most people confronted with the choice, if you like, make the decision you made.
Right.
Which is to turn away from violence.
Right.
So there is something unusual, peculiar, if you like, about those who actually take up the bomb or the gun.
Right. And that's one of the reasons why it's so hard to identify the causes of terrorism. Well, there's two reasons. One is because there's so many terrorists. How do you possibly have a single explanation for the behaviour of a cricket player in Leeds, a Tamil tiger, an Irish teacher, a Saudi imam? On the other hand, is actually the other reason it's so hard is precisely the one you point out. There are so few terrorists. So if poverty, for example, caused terrorism, we'd have far more terrorists than we have in the world today, and they'd be in different places. Or if alienation caused terrorism, there'd be more terrorists. So it is a combination of factors. I mean, my argument is that what you need for terrorism is a disaffected individual, a like-minded group or organization, a community that's complicit with your violence, and a legitimizing ideology. So it's really a lethal cocktail with these four essential ingredients. That
George Bush would have said maybe added evil and hatred as ingredients that drive people.
Well, I have a very different perspective on terrorism than President Bush. I think what drives them is something different. I think they're driven by three factors, and the first and most powerful one is revenge, a desire for revenge. Sometimes for something they personally have suffered, but most often for something, an ill that has been visited on a broader community with which they identify. So I think they want, above all, revenge. Secondly, I think they want glory or renown. Now, sometimes if this is just the rank and file, this is renown in terms of increased social status in their community by virtue of membership in this organization. But if they're a leader like bin Laden or Azwahiri, they want renown on the global stage. They want to be considered global leaders. The third thing they want, I believe, is a reaction. They want to provoke us into reacting, because terrorists are invariably both outmanned and outgunned by their adversaries. So they, by provoking us into a reaction, that's how we demonstrate how important they are. They don't have armies. They don't have territory that they can control. So they have their ability to provoke us into reacting.
You also say that terrorism can't be defeated, that the best we can hope for is to contain it.
Right.
Now, is that really what we're facing with, for example, Al-Qaeda?
Yes, I think so. Terrorism is simply a tactic, and terror is an emotion. So in my view, it makes no more sense to declare war on the tactic of terrorism, much less the emotion of terror, than on any other tactic or emotion. We can never make our societies so invulnerable to any terrorist attack that we will never face one. And it seems to me we shouldn't try, because the price of doing that is too high.
But your own book, What Terrorists Want, identifies situations and cases in which terrorist organizations have been defeated, haven't they? The Shining Path in South America, the PKK in Turkey. Now, I mean, and you analyze the tactics which were used and which were successful. So to that extent, terrorism or terrorist organizations can be defeated.
In particular instances, yes, they can. And again, part of the question is always when do you ask the question? At various points, terrorist groups, well, like the LTTE at the moment, the Tamil Tigers, they would appear to be defeated. I think it's an open question whether they reemerge again. I worry that the brutality of the government's response was such as to lead to the generation of the production of new generation of supporters for the LTTE. So yes, there have been instances when terrorist groups have grown to the extent that they could launch a conventional
battles, as indeed the two you mentioned, the Sendero and the PKK, that they were able to be defeated militarily. But that's not what we're facing today in the case of Al-Qaeda. They're not in a position to launch conventional armies against us.
And of course, the other point that's made sometimes about Al-Qaeda is that it's a completely new threat, if you like. First of all, because of the scale of the violence that it's prepared to inflict. And secondly, because it doesn't seem really to have demands that could be met in any kind of way. That it's an obvious, you can't sit down and negotiate with these people and achieve a political settlement, like, for example, we saw in Northern Ireland. And so it's a very different and very much more dangerous kind of threat for those two reasons.
I think it is different, and I think it is more dangerous, but I think there are many areas in which it's less different and more similar to others. If you think about the groups that bedeviled Europe in the 1970s, the Red Army faction in Germany, the Red Brigades in Italy, these groups also had transformational aspirations. They wanted to overthrow capitalism. I mean, you can't negotiate with somebody who wants to overthrow capitalism. I think Al-Qaeda's strength is twofold. First is that it has an ideology that so many people find attractive. And secondly, it has this organizational ability to morph, if you like. Initially, prior to September 11, it was fairly conventionally organized. Now it has transformed itself very effectively into a kind of franchise operation. But I think you're quite right that they, unlike, say, the IRA, didn't have specific political objectives over which you can negotiate. If your audience is God, you don't have to be quite so constrained. But I think this is easy to overstate. There was a letter intercepted, sent from al-Zawahiri, who's the number two man in al-Qaeda, to Zarqawi, the late and unlamented al-Qaeda thug in Iraq, the man responsible for cutting the throats of people he kidnapped. And in this letter, al-Zawahiri told Zarqawi to stop slitting the throats of his kidnapped victims, because he said that's so brutal that it's alienating the Muslim population. And the basis of our support, the basis of our strength, is the support we get from Muslims worldwide. So there is an instance in which they're constraining their violence so as not to lose broad appeal. So I think even there they are constrained.
Where do you think are the roots of the hostility between the United States and the large parts of the Muslim world? Where did that start?
Well, I have to say, I think the American government's conduct of its foreign policy, especially in recent years, has been unwise and in some instances almost calculated to generate opposition. I would say that America is the most powerful country in the history of the planet. Any time you have a global hegemon, they are unpopular. The Romans were, the British were, still are in some places. The Americans clearly are. There are particular areas like the Israeli-Palestinian issue, for example. This is an issue that generates resentment the world over. I think and I hope the Obama administration will put an enormous amount of effort into trying to resolve this problem. Now, America, powerful as it is, isn't powerful enough to solve every problem. Another would be Kashmir, for example, that serves as a spawning ground for extremists. But by endeavoring to remove these conflicts, you're removing arguments from your adversary. I think America is a very idealistic society. I think even the Bush administration genuinely thought that they were trying, that they could export democracy to the world, genuinely thought that if they brought down Saddam Hussein, they would be welcomed and introduced democracy. That's based on really an extraordinary ignorance of the rest of the world and the ignorance of the complexities of the society.
I mean, American people seemed, perhaps understandably, very shocked by 9/11. I mean, obviously shocked by the scale of the killing and the destruction and the death that was visited by the terrorists, but also shocked that America could be hated so much. That seems to have been something that Americans had no notion of, that there were people out there who hated America.
Right. I think that's true. I think you're right. September 11 was deeply shocking, and only that can explain the extent and I think the catastrophe of the American reaction, I would argue overreaction to September 11th, which has done so much to undermine the American position in the world, not to mention, you know, led to countless deaths. I think it was the sense that suddenly America was no longer invulnerable. I mean, America has a unique political history. It has two weak neighbors and oceans on either side. So it's actually never been threatened. So suddenly America was not invulnerable. But there is a real sense of idealism and a real sense that their virtue is self-evident. And I think what Americans don't realise and what the last administration failed to do was to try to educate the American public about the implications of being citizens of the most powerful country on the planet, about how American policies are perceived on the ground. I mean, take, for example, the particular issue that led to the organisation of Al-Qaeda was the deployment of American troops in Saudi Arabia after the first Gulf War. And Americans did this as a practical response. They could just as easily have placed those troops on an aircraft carrier. It would have cost more money, but it would have removed this extraordinary resentment that bin Laden was able to capitalize on.
The point though, made by Bush in the years after 9/11, and particularly after the invasion of Afghanistan and then Iraq, was that he was taking the war to the terrorists, to those who would kill Americans. And he was able to say that in the years since 9/11, there were no further terrorist attacks on American soil. He protected the United States of America.
I would agree that there were no attacks on American soil. I would not agree that he protected the United States of America, because if you actually look at who is doing the fighting in Iraq, these were not people who were otherwise planning to come to America. These were young Algerians, Moroccans, Saudis who were radicalized by the war in Iraq and because of the war in Iraq traveled there to wage war on America. So it may indeed be that there were no further attacks because Al-Qaeda wasn't strong enough to launch them.
But of course, what Al-Qaeda did was it targeted America's allies in Europe and elsewhere. And we had the bombings in Madrid and in London, for example. So that became, I suppose, maybe the soft underbelly of the Western response
That's
to 9/11.
Right. And in both those instances, of course, you had, these were homegrown terrorists, if you like, unlike in the US, where there simply isn't a large alienated Muslim population. Islamic immigrants in the US tend to be very well integrated and quite loyal to the US. So the situations there are quite different. But yes, you did have these two tragic events.
Yeah, and the London bombings, again, another aspect of that was very shocking for British people, was that these bombers were part of their community. As you say, they played cricket and ran youth clubs and were, to all intents and purposes, perfectly normal, well-adjusted members of British society.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it is deeply troubling to try to understand this. And part of the explanation, I think, from what we know about these four, again, they were radicalized by the war in Iraq and by Britain's role in that war, and also by their contacts with people in Pakistan in particular. And one of the most troubling aspects, I think, of the conflict we now face that makes it quite different from anything we've seen in the past is the role of the internet. I mean, people like bin Laden are very quick to criticize globalization as a form of American neo-imperialism, but actually they're very clever about how they use it. I mean, absent the internet, they could not function. They use it to communicate, to create virtual communities of support. So you could have these young men in Leeds playing cricket by day and then going up to their bedrooms and communing with radicals in Pakistan. So this is really troubling development.
So if this threat is to be contained, how do we contain it? Would capturing bin Laden severely disable the organization, or is Al-Qaeda well able to survive the capture of its leader, its inspiration?
I think he's a very smart organizational player, and he's made sure that the organization will survive his capture or killing. I mean, some organizations like the PKK and the Shining Path, both of them you mentioned earlier, part of the success in defeating them was the fact that they were decapitated. But in both those cases, those organizations were organized around one central leader, very brilliant, very charismatic leader. Now, bin Laden has gone to great efforts to ensure that his organization is not organized in the same way so that it can survive his death. And he has said repeatedly that it is Allah who will decide when he dies, so that even if we were to kill him, he's ensuring that we wouldn't get credit for it because it's Allah's decision, not ours. So So Al-Qaeda will continue after bin Laden.
So what do we do then? There's a new president now, obviously. Right. So there's a change of regime, a new attitude, it would seem, right, towards the Middle East. We had this speech earlier in the year, right, by President Obama in Cairo. It seems, mm-hmm, trying to hold out a hand of friendship and partnership, right, to the Muslim world.
Right. I have great optimism for the Obama administration. So if I were... creating counterterrorism policy, it would be guided by several principles, at least six, and I'll try and run through them quickly. First, simply to have patience and keep our perspective. 20 years ago, we had 30,000 Soviet thermonuclear weapons trained on American cities, and Americans yet feel more vulnerable to attack by a terrorist, when statistically they're as likely to die in their bathtubs or from a bee sting or a bolt of lightning. So we need to keep this threat in perspective. Secondly, I think we need to live by our principles. I think untold harm was done to America's moral authority and reputation in the world by the pictures of Abu Ghraib and indeed Guantanamo that have been seen. We cannot sacrifice the civil liberties that we have in our societies in the name of security. I think it's just a short-term measure, ultimately damaging in the long term. Third, we have to engage others with us in countering terrorism. And by that I mean moderates in the communities in which we're trying to operate, in which the terrorist groups win recruits. And we also need to create a counter-narrative. I think we in the West have an extraordinary, compelling story to tell, and we're completely failing to tell it. With the mass media, the command of the mass media in this country, we should be engaging overseas in persuading moderates in the countries in which Al-Qaeda is trying to recruit what these guys are really doing. The number of Muslims that they massacre every time they try and kill a few Westerners, they generally kill more Muslims. We need to be out there engaging with them and selling the Western story. I mean, many, indeed in the US, the Islamic population is deeply loyal and indeed the best advocates for the American in particular way of life. I think we also need to address the political issues like Israel, like Kashmir, that are being exploited by our adversaries in an effort to undermine us and win support for themselves. And we need to think about the implications of our policies on the ground. Part of the assessment of the efficacy of that policy is what are the local reactions to it likely to be. I mean, ironically, some of the most successful Western counterterrorism policies have been policies that weren't introduced to counterterrorism at all, but rather the tsunami relief in Indonesia, for example, or indeed the earthquake relief in Pakistan. The generosity of Western assistance in those instances went a huge way towards persuading the recipients of that assistance that, in fact, the West was not out to wage war on them, but actually interested in helping them. So there's a great deal we can do.
We saw for many years in this country British and Irish governments saying we'd never negotiate with terrorists. Mm-hmm. Now, in the end, I suppose you could argue that's what happened. Republicans right. were brought into the mm-hmm. the process and engaged with and negotiated with. Mm-hmm. Could you see circumstances in which it would be possible to negotiate with Al-Qaeda?
I think we have to engage with all our adversaries. I'm a complete pragmatist on this. Every government has always said that, no, we won't negotiate with terrorists, and just about every government does. Now, the situation, as you said earlier, in Northern Ireland was very different because there was a coherent political aspiration that could be negotiated over, as there is in Sri Lanka, for example, or as there is in any nationalist instance. So, and I think if a government representative were to sit down with a representative of Al-Qaeda, for example, it would be to provide them with legitimacy that we don't want to do. So I think before one would do that, one would have behind the scenes engagement. And I think if you look at the success of the military action in Iraq, I believe that a part of that success was precisely the engagement with the adversary by members of the American military. Engagement not with the entire adversary, but with parts of it. You know, part of the goal of engagement should actually be to understand the internal dynamics of your adversary and to encourage splits within that organization. We always assume that the people on the other side are united. We always know that on our side there's various ranges of opinion, but we assume the other is the unitary actor. But the closer you get to the other, you realize that even in Al-Qaeda there's actually lots of differences of opinion, and it would be very much in our interest to exacerbate those differences of opinion so that they can start turning on one another.
Do people who make policy in governments around the world, United States I suppose in your case, maybe the United Kingdom, do they listen to people like you?
Sometimes. I think the Bush administration was not terribly interested in listening to people who had a different perspective than they do. I think the military is usually the very first to look for others, to look for outside positions. Usually the military are ahead of the game in anticipating creative responses. I think very often people have this notion of militaries as very conservative organizations. That hasn't been my experience at all. So yes, I've spent a good deal of time talking to the military in various countries, and indeed intelligence services in various countries.
And how on top of their game, if I can put it that way, are the intelligence services, do you think? Because obviously there was a great deal of criticism of the American CIA and other intelligence services in the aftermath of 9/11, mm-hmm. and when the commission mm-hmm. published its report. Are they learning the lessons of that episode?
I think one of the real tragedies of the past several years is that rather than learning the lessons from others' experience, America has learned from their own experience. So America is now realizing the inadequacies of relying on the military to defeat terrorism, for example. But they could have learned the same lesson if they simply looked at Northern Ireland or indeed at a range of other cases. I think they've lost a lot of time. They've been very slow to learn. They've made the mistakes. And also intelligence is a very difficult business. It takes a lot of time. It requires building up human relationships. And this takes years. I think the mistake prior to 9/11 was a reliance on technology, the assumption that with American technology we didn't need to have people on the ground developing relationships, joining terrorist groups. I think we should have, any time that a terrorist cell convenes, I would like to think that at least somebody, one of the members present, was on our side. But that takes a lot of time. So they are learning, but it'll take time.
Ms. Richardson, thanks very much indeed for talking to us.